Good morning, Movement Makers. Happy Tuesday. I am excited to be here with you guys again. Just for the record, my name is Holly Keel. I am part of Pedro Deo's team and co-hosting this challenge with your amazing host, Pedro Deo. And I am excited to come on this morning and just welcome you in for day two. I don't know about you guys, but yesterday was power-packed. I wrote a bunch of things down. I love learning and sitting and gleaning. And I know that to miss a little bit of what Pedro was doing is to miss a lot. So I just want to say pat yourself on the back. You have showed up to position yourself to learn a lot today. So if you are on right now, I am going to go look at the comments. I want to see you guys saying good morning. I want to see you guys tagging your friends who you know are in this challenge with you. We've encouraged you guys to invite a challenge buddy. So if you do not see them on this live, go ahead and do that. But I just wanted to say good morning to a bunch of you. I see Michelle, Amina, Corey. Good morning, guys. It's so good to see you on here. I'm excited to jump in and get going with you. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. Yesterday, Pedro went through this and you guys saw this a little bit. I'm just excited. I mean, who doesn't look at this lineup of powerful entrepreneurs who are making an impact in the world around them right now and just not get so excited that there is hope, that there is education for you to do the same in your life. And I just love looking at this lineup. But today we're going to be talking about how to create a micro niche. This was one of my biggest takeaways yesterday. I love when Pedro talks about this. And today he's going even deeper into this topic. You guys are not going to want to miss this. So make sure you're tuned in, put away the distractions, stay locked in for the next hour because he is going to give you keys that will unlock your superpower as being a movement maker. So stay present, stay connected for this, guys. And then also, you guys know he is your coach and mentor this week. I'm going to bring him on screen in just a second after we go through the logistics of all the things that we need to go over today. But guys, I love this picture of him with all of his Comic Club awards and holding his 8-figure 2X. It's so exciting to see that. And it's just inspiring. So stay locked in if you guys have not. Yesterday, we got amazing statistics that you guys plugged in, that you went to crushitlab.com, that you got your homework there, that you interacted with Gangsta P. Can I see in the comments how many of you drop an emoji, a fire emoji, or a that's me hand raising emoji? If you guys went there and you got value from this, this is something new and exciting that we're implementing this challenge. And so far, the stats are in that this is really powerful. You guys are really getting a lot from it. So if you did not go yesterday, make sure you go today to crushitlab.com. This is not only where you get to interact with Gangsta P with that grill and his little bling, but you'll also get your homework, the recap video, and any other information that you need there. So it's a really valuable tool for you guys. And then, of course, a lot of people have been asking us, how do I win the prizes? There's $25,000 in prizes? What the heck? Yes, this is true. There are $25,000 in prizes that Pedro is giving away. And one of them I have attended, and it is absolutely worth its weight in gold over and over and over again, is a 2-day challenge workshop. So make sure that you're being present to win. And I'm going to go over those in just a second. Also, the Crush It With Challenge course. We have seen thousands of people come through this course, take this course, launch their challenge, launch their business, and have wild success. So one person will win that. And then, of course, we also have an hour one-on-one. If you missed any kickoff call, we did some math that gave us the clue that Pedro's 1 minute is worth $166. Yes, that's true. $166 for 1 minute. And you get a full hour with Pedro. So that's going to be a hot commodity as well. As a Vibe whiteboard, you guys have seen him use a similar thing in the background. An iPhone 12. Love my iPhone 12. So all you need these days is that to run a business. And then a Microsoft Studio, which he uses. That's his 4K camera that you guys see him live stream from, as well as if you've seen him write and train on his computer. That's what he's using. These prizes will literally launch and change your business. So make sure you're staying connected. Make sure that you're registered at movementmaker.com. Make sure that you text Pedro the word movement to the phone number that's on the screen right there. Also, make sure that you join the Facebook group. We're streaming this in a few different places. If you're watching on YouTube or a different Facebook group, make sure that you're getting into the Movement Maker Facebook group, because that's where a lot of the meat is happening, guys. And then last but not least, I think this is one of the most powerful ones. Definitely complete that daily assignment at crushitlab.com and then go live in the Facebook group. I am watching your guys' lives and I get so excited when I see your breakthroughs, guys. This is powerful, powerful stuff. I'm watching this model unfold right in front of my eyes as though I don't know it already works, but it's so amazing. So make sure you're doing your homework. You're grabbing that at crushitlab.com and going live in the community. And then just a few little housekeeping things. Replays, worksheets, they used to be called the units tab. Right now, Facebook has changed them. They're called the guides tab. You'll notice in there. Also, I've done a little checklist for you guys. So it's like, did that. I like to check things off my list. I don't know about you. If you're a checklist kind of person, drop that in the comments. Like checklist, that's how I function. So checklisters out there, there's a checklist for you to make sure that you've got all your bases covered. And then give the trainings the time. Guys, give them the full attention in your whole heart. On Friday, when we did the kickoff training, we talked about holding space for what's happening right here in this challenge. There are literal lives being changed. Pedro mentioned yesterday, your life pre-movement maker challenge and your life post-movement maker challenge. You will see a difference if you plug in and play full out. So take this serious. If you're in a place where you're like, I'm stuck, I don't know what I'm doing, here's where you get unlocked. Here's where you get the keys to move forward. So like I said earlier, to miss a little is to miss a lot. Carve out this time, guys. This is going to change your life if you allow it. You get to make that choice. And then the last thing is, please respect the community. No pitching, dropping links. Nobody likes to be pitched, right? Sometimes there's some of us that like to be sold, but we don't like to be pitched. This is not the place to do it. This is not, hey, I do this thing, come buy it from me. Let me DM you on the side. This isn't a place for that, guys. We're hungry entrepreneurs showing up to learn a valuable skill set. And so make sure that you're creating that atmosphere by not going above and beyond to DM or pitch people. And then lastly, before I hand you guys off to Pedro, I want to give you our little agenda for today. Very, very quick. He's going to talk a little bit more on movement making, why and how and why it's important. But then this is his goal. This is where he shines, guys. This is where he shines. He's going to teach you how to create a micro niche. I saw yesterday there was a whole conversation on how you say it. Micro niche, guys. He is going in deep. This is the secret sauce. This is the good stuff. So make sure you are fully tuned in, present and focused. You are not going to want to miss that. So without any further ado, I would like to welcome to this virtual stage in this challenge right here with you, Movement Makers, your coach, your mentor, your leader for this week, who is here showing up for you going all out as a 8-figure entrepreneur and highly sought after leader and creator of challenges, perfecter, the challenge guy, Pedro Adeo.
What is up, Holly? Good morning. How are you? Guys, welcome to day two. And did you guys catch Holly's new office backdrop? I was like, yes, looking fresh over there. Holly, guys, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to day two. Super excited to be back with you yet again. And it's only going to build. Today, yesterday, you guys got a good flavor for Gangsta P, a lot of passion for myself yesterday. Kind of kick off on a high level energy. Today, we're going to now start to get into a little bit more of the teaching and the framework. So I might throttle back the energy a little bit today just to really make sure that we're getting these concepts deep into our mind, our heart, and most importantly, in here. If it doesn't go in here, it won't come out here. So guys, these concepts gotta go in deep before they can come out. So with that, guys, I'm ready to get started. If you are ready, just let me know you're ready by typing ready in the chat, and let's rock and roll. And I have a guest. I have a guest. We have some guests that are in the house. So be ready for that. And I know Holly already covered this, so let me just click. Good job, Holly, on that. All right, guys. So as Holly said, this is the plan for today. I'm just gonna pull up my little, my phone here so I can see what's happening in the comments. I always like to do that. With StreamYard, once you go live, that's kind of an interesting thing about StreamYard. Once you go live with slides, you kind of lose the comments. So all right, guys. And Holly, can you make them like a little bit better, like kind of like yesterday a little bit? Okay, guys. So quick recap. Let me do a quick recap. Quick recap of a little bit yesterday, build on that a little bit, and then we're gonna wrap up today talking about how to create a micro niche. My job today is to get you convinced that you absolutely must create a micro niche. But Pedro, I thought this was all about challenges. It's yes, we're gonna get the challenges. That's gonna be all Thursdays, gonna be all about challenges. But I'm here to help set you up to have a massive success with your challenge. And every single successful challenge that I've been a part of, that I've observed, for early stage entrepreneurs and even advanced entrepreneurs, they had a very specific targeted niche they were serving. So just to recap from yesterday, what makes a movement? Movements must have a cause. So I'm here to help you understand this idea of movement making, so we can help you turn your business and what you do from just a product, just a service, and actually wrapping a powerful cause-based message around that. So you can identify and people identify with you that want what you do and are all in to be with you and the brand you're building. Movements take a stand for something, and they also take a stand against something. So remember that. You must take a stand, okay? And so this is what's gonna drive your copy, your advertising, your messaging. Movements gather, allow people to unite in a shared interest or passion or cause, and movements all have a leader, but the movement transcends the leader. You know you have a real movement. You know you have a real movement-based business when it's just growing and it's bigger than you. And that's really fun when that starts to happen. So here's some must-have. Movements require passion. Doesn't require yelling, doesn't require screaming. You don't have to be an off-the-charts extrovert, but you do must have passion. People are looking for leaders who are not just passionate, but certain and confident. And passion usually is found when you have certainty and confidence. Passion is usually a byproduct. Movements have an urgency about them that gets people to want to move with you now. And this is very important because a lot of people, there's a lot of people that are just, procrastinate and have a hard time making decisions. And so I do think it's absolutely important that your movement has a quickening process, that people just see it and they can connect to it quickly, which is why you must be super clear on who this movement is for and what it's about, okay? And Holly, I think you were right. Well, let's flip the view. Let's go ahead and make the slides a little bigger. I think you were right the first time, so my apologies. And then guys, movements are typically designed and organized around seeking to eliminate a specific problem. We'll come back to that more in a second. So movements are usually around eliminating a problem, and movement makers usually are the people that can clearly, guys, catch this, movement makers are and market leaders are generally the people that can clearly articulate the problem the best. More on that later, okay? Now here's some must-haves. Movements are about beliefs in action. And the most successful movements are giving people a new identity, giving people something to identify with. And in times of turmoil, in times of uncertainty, in times of crisis, much like what's happening now in the world, even more so are people looking to connect themselves and to identify to something bigger than them. So there couldn't be a better time for you to understand how this movement making process happens so you can get involved with it. Now, here are some major mistakes that you're gonna have to avoid and overcome to actually press through and have the benefits of having a movement-based business. First of all, you're gonna have to overcome overthinking, and more on that later. But overthinking, I absolutely believe, is the number one thing that plagues and hinders aspiring entrepreneurs. I can tell you this from experience, because of the friends I get to have now and the people I get to network with and mastermind with, successful leaders and successful entrepreneurs, people that have scaled to past a million and beyond, they have developed what I call decision-making muscles. They do not overthink things. What does that mean, Pedro? They just make rash decisions? No, they don't just make rash decisions, but they don't dwell and ponder overly. They don't sit still. They think about it, they evaluate, they make the best decision they can in the moment with the knowledge they have, and then they go. And they trust the process, and they trust that they can overcorrect. And Holly, whenever you're ready, go ahead and feel free to drop a worksheet whenever it's available. Another mistake I see people make is trying to plan too far ahead. Okay, let me tell you this. If you have a real movement and you're an early stage entrepreneur, don't expect to see too far down the road. It's just not how this stuff happens. It's just not really how it happens. I can tell you this, after 3 years of being, online, with both HunterX and now Crusher with Challenges, 3 years having scaled to where we're at now, I'm just now starting to maybe see vision for the next 12 to 24 months. And that's just now. Like up until maybe a year ago, I was pretty much running the company kind of like 30 days at a time. Like we didn't really know too much ahead, and that's okay, guys. What a blessing to not know, have to know the future. Just, it helps you stay locked in on what's happening right now. How many of you would admit that you struggle with overthinking and wanting to know all the details right now? How many of you guys are willing to admit that? If that's you, you can just, let's just say, type details. If that's you, just type in details in the chat. And guys, there's nothing wrong with details, but you have to understand the details always come last. The details always come later. And if you're gonna want to really have success in this modern era of online marketing and movement making, you're gonna have to increase your capacity for uncertainty. Write that down. That is a writer downer. What is my capacity and my willingness to embrace uncertainty? Guys, I had no plan to ever launch Crush It with Challenges. I had no plan to ever being the challenge guy. There's no vision board. There's no journal. There was no plan to launch 100X. Guys, some of the greatest things in my life have happened recently. There was no plan for it at all. I was just doing the obvious next step. I was staying locked in and just doing a good job with the step I'm on. Too many entrepreneurs are trying to work on step 7 when they're on step 2. And so don't make that mistake. Well, Pedro, what if I look stupid? Well, you probably are. You already are looking stupid to some people. Guys, there's people that call me stupid every day. There's people that call me stupid every day, and much worse, right? Have you seen the comments on my ads? Have you ever run ads before? Trust me, like when you start running ads, you're gonna find out not everybody's super nice. So you're gonna have to get over this. You just have to learn not to care what random people think. Like, of course, some people will think you're stupid. regardless of what you're doing, how you're doing it, regardless of how awesome it is, some people will always think you're stupid, and I think you just need to learn to be okay with that. Okay. Another big mistake is, Pedro, I'm not famous, I'm not an influencer, no one knows me. How can I have a movement? Oh, the same way I have mine's, you know, the same way we've done a couple times. You don't need to be famous or an influencer to start to make this work. That's the whole reason why I'm here showing this to you. Because I know most of you are early stage entrepreneurs that don't have social reach, that don't have big platforms, that don't have huge email lists. Just like I was 3 years ago, a complete unknown with no email list, no Facebook following, no Instagram following. And we've been able to build 3 different movement-based businesses from scratch. And that's the blueprint I'm handing you guys today and over the next 5 days. Here's a big one. This is kind of like an imposter syndrome, or it's kind of like just surely, Pedro, someone else is more qualified to run this movement. Surely there must be someone out there who knows more than me on this topic. And you know what? That could be true. But here's the crazy thing about this. You don't have to know the most to be the most effective leader. Movement making, being a leader, impacting people has a lot more to do with willingness. Your willingness helps you get more qualified. There are many people there are folks that may know more than you right now, but they may not be willing to push in to becoming a movement maker. So this really comes down to your willingness, not so much your expertise. Do I want you to have expertise? Of course. Do I want you to know your stuff? Certainly. Do I want you to be the best in what you do? Of course I do. And yet you don't have to be wondering, oh my God, well, there's someone better than me, right? How can I do this? The fact is, even if there's someone more skilled, but if they're not sharing it, teaching it, doing anything with it, then it's not available. Okay. A couple more things. You can, guys, this is one that I'm just gonna be real. You have to be very careful about listening to normal people, doing what normal people do. Newsflash. You are not normal. You, my friend, are not normal. Pedro, what do you mean? You're not normal. The fact that you would show up to something called the Movement Maker Challenge proves you're not normal. Because normal people aren't even trying to be movement makers. Normal people aren't even thinking about being a movement maker. Normal people don't think like this. They don't show up for these kind of things. Normal people are getting through life, trying to pay some bills, trying to go on a vacation once a year, and just kind of trying to keep everything afloat. Normal people are about the status quo and just kind of making sure things are okay. You are not normal, so don't listen to normal people. Don't take advice from normal people, because you're not normal. Another mistake I see. Sometimes movement makers and leaders and entrepreneurs, they got their head in the clouds. It's all this big stuff. It's always big picture this and big picture that. And yes, they may have vision, and they may have a big vision for big impact. But oftentimes those people that I see who talk about the bigness and vastness of the movement they feel called to lead, they like to live in the fantasy of that story, and they're usually not taking enough action. Movement makers are people of action. I've never seen a movement maker who wasn't action-oriented. A couple last things here. Be very careful of what fuel you connect your movement to. Do not pick the wrong fuel supply. Pedro, what do you mean? There are movements. You can build your movement on anger. You can build your movement on rage. You can build your movement on victim narratives. Those movements will not last. They will implode. I'm gonna recommend to you that when you think about launching your movement, you connect into things like love, truth, righteousness, things that can only grow and expand. Okay. And so I've just seen this happen. I've seen this happen time and time again, where you can get momentum. It's easy to gather angry people. That's not hard to do. It's easy to gather disgruntled people. That's not hard. But how can you take that anger, take that rage, and then redirect it and give it a powerful purpose for good? That's what makes movements last forever. Guys, don't try to be too fancy too soon. Don't worry about all the fancy stuff. Oh, Pedro, you got this awesome office. You got these fancy screens. You know what? I didn't have that to start. You guys, if you have a cell phone, you're in the game. If you have a cell phone and a Facebook account and Instagram, you're in the game. And listen, don't worry about being politically correct. You're like, well, Pedro, what does that mean? Like, are you telling me I should offend people? Well, yeah. Yep. That's probably what I'm telling you. Now, I don't like to offend people on purpose per se, but I know that there's things I say, the things I take a stand for, the things I take a stand against. I know that my delivery style, my energy, my passion, I know that it's going to attract certain people, and it's going to actually push away other people. Okay. And I know that, guys. Like, I know that, and I'm totally fine with that. So right now in this cancel culture, everyone is so worried about getting canceled, and everyone's so sensitive right now. And so I'm telling you right now, like, it's, you know, if you get too worried about offending people, you're going to end up censoring yourself so much that your words will have no life on them. They'll be like, wah, 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 wah. Okay. Now, again, respect people, honor people. Absolutely. We should never seek to be offensive to people individually, but your thoughts, what you take a stand for, may be offensive to established patterns. They may be offensive to the status quo. There should be most movements that are growing quickly and have energy to them. There's an element of controversy. There's an element where they're going against the grain. Okay. They're pushing against the status quo and the norm. And so anytime you're doing that, then of course you're going to see that you might offend some folks. And again, pick the right enemy. Many movements fail because they pick the wrong enemy. Okay. Make sure you're pushing against the actual, make sure that you are fighting against the right thing. And usually I'm going to recommend, it's probably not a person. It's not a person. Okay. It's actually typically a mindset, a belief system. Okay. If you make your movements about fighting other people, I think you've already lost. Make your movements about fighting the belief systems, the mindsets, and the systemic reasons and problems that are causing that thing to happen. Okay. And so, all right, guys, here's how you accelerate your movement. And we're going to get into some niching. Stand for truth. Stand for what is right. When you stand for truth, there is a power and an authority that comes on you, because there's nothing more powerful in this world, in the universe, than truth. Truth stands. tall. Truth speaks for itself. Truth never needs to be defended. It's just evident when it's there, shining bright. Begin to gather testimonies of breakthrough and transformation. I call these modern day miracles. Yesterday in the backstage, we had my good friends, Alex and Layla Hormozy, who have literally helped thousands and thousands of gym owners who were on the brink of bankruptcy, the brink of losing everything because their gyms were failing. And they literally turned these gyms that were dead on life support and within a matter of months, turned them into vibrant, growing, healthy, profitable businesses. Guys, that's a miracle. This was a dead gym. I was about to die, go out of business. And they take a dead gym with an overwhelmed gym owner on his last legs and within a matter of weeks and months, flip that to a thriving business. Guys, that's a modern day miracle. Your movement should have testimonies of these miracle stories. And you're going to see some of those today from our work and the rest of the week. So be a collector and gatherer of these stories. Guys, how am I doing so far? Okay. How am I doing so far? We're about halfway in. How many of you guys like the calmer, this little bit of calmer? You know, this is what we call Papa P. Where Papa P just likes to teach a little bit. And how many of you guys are enjoying this flow? Okay. All right. And create an environment where people can connect. All right. Here we go. Here's a big one. You can quickly accelerate your movement, your prominence, and your influence by understanding the problem better than anyone else. I'm going to pause right here. This is a biggie. Okay, biggie. I believe whoever understands the problem the best, the real problem, has a strategic advantage at winning the game. But Pedro, how do I understand the problem? This is about just time, energy, hustle, care, asking questions, surveys, talking to people, connecting to people, jumping in forums, Reddit forums, jumping in Facebook groups, engaging. That's about research, guys. That's about doing the research and asking the best questions. Because the problem is actually, the problem that people think they have is typically not the real problem. That's the superficial problem. There's a deeper problem that they are not aware of. See, people have problem awareness here, but most people don't understand the problem at the surface level that's actually causing this problem. And if you can get to that level of understanding and mastery, you can win the game. And then, of course, for your movement to grow fast, you've got to articulate what success looks like. What is the path? How will we know when we're winning? You, as the movement maker and leader, get to determine that. You set that threshold. You set that bar. You communicate that path. Okay? All right. So leaders of movements, I have found, are usually great students of other leaders and mentors. So are you willing to be a student? Because I've never seen a great leader who has not been groomed and studied and been mentored and poured into by other great leaders. And the last question before I get to micro-niching is this. Pedro, how will I know when I'm ready to lead a movement? You probably won't. You probably won't know when you're ready. Okay. And the fact is, the more ready that you think you are, the more convinced that you're ready, might mean you're not ready. Sometimes I meet people who, like, they just are like, Pedro, I'm amazing, I'm incredible, I've done all these things, I'm ready to, you know. And usually I'm like, man, wow, like, a lot of pride, a lot of arrogance, a lot of blind spots. And then I'm like, oh, we'll see. And sometimes the people who think they're the least ready to lead are actually the most ready. So listen, you might not know. If you think I had any idea 3 years ago when I did a free masterclass, I was going to be leading a global movement of faith-based entrepreneurs, you're out of your mind. I had no idea that was even about to happen. If you think a year ago I knew I was going to be leading an industry revolutionary marketing framework and leading people into a whole new way of communicating and serving and solving problems with challenges, nope, didn't see that coming either. And here's what's so cool. This takes all the pressure off. So if you don't feel ready to lead a movement, don't worry. You're probably in good company. Now, all right, guys, we're going to shift. Type shift in the chat if you're ready to shift, okay? Hopefully you guys got some good notes. If you got some good notes, can you put some fire? Put some hearts. If you got some good notes as we kind of wrapped up some of the movement making convo, let me see a little love in the chat for that little bit of content there. Guys, movement making, this is the stuff. Leadership, John Maxwell. What is John Maxwell? John Maxwell says, everything rises and falls on leadership. So I'm here to help you be an amazing leader for your movement, for your company, for the people that you're called to serve. And now I want to start to get into this framework, guys, this three-part framework that has absolutely allowed us to do all that we've been able to do these last 3 years. It was these three steps here. How we were able to launch 100X to the number one position in faith-based entrepreneurship market. How we've been able to launch Crush It with Challenges to, again, the number one industry leader for challenge-based marketing. It's right here. This is the three-step path. And today we're going to go in on carving a micro niche. So if you're ready to shift, then again, type shift and let's go. All right. So, guys, there's a reason why this is number one. This really is the most important first step. Angel, you're the challenge guy. You're not the micro niche guy. I would think challenges would be the most important. The challenge is incredibly important because the challenge is the megaphone. The challenge is what takes your message and your movement to the world, to your world. The challenge is how it gets out. The challenge is your distribution system. It's your marketing system. It is incredibly vital. And yet, I tell you right now, the people who have crushed challenges and amazing businesses, I help them all do this first. So let's roll into carving a micro niche. Okay, guys, oh my word. John Lee Dumas yesterday in the VIP, in the backstage VIP, I could not summarize it better. And so I'm gonna use him as an example before I show you guys a few examples of mine and some of our students, okay? So guys, VIP yesterday. If you were in VIP yesterday, can you just put some fire for how incredible VIP was? And Holly, I'm gonna have you get that VIP link up in a little bit because guys, we're just getting started and every single one of you should be in that VIP backstage pass. So guys, let me tell you about JLD. JLD is my co-host in the VIP backstage pass. He has, you know, a small little podcast called Entrepreneurs on Fire, okay? I'm making a joke. It's a massive podcast. John launched his podcast in 2012, 9 years ago. So I would say John was pretty early to the podcasting game. Wouldn't you agree? Wouldn't you agree that John was pretty early to podcasting? There's probably now millions and millions and millions more podcasts in 2021 than there even were in 2012. But this is what JLD said to break down how he picked his idea for his podcast 9 years ago in an incredibly less noisy world. John knew he wanted to be in the entrepreneurship space. That was the main industry John wanted to be in. And the sub industry he wanted to go into was podcasting. So then John began to do some research and say, okay, I want to podcast in the I want to be an entrepreneur in the podcasting space, and I want to talk about business. So John did some research and he found out, shoot, shucks, right? There's already 300 other podcasts talking about business. Guys, that was in 2012. Imagine what that number is today. So in 2012, John counted, there was already 300 other podcasts talking about business. So John's like, okay, I can't just talk about business because I'll be 301. And who the heck wants to be 301? Nobody. So John goes, I know, I'm gonna carve a sub niche, and I'm gonna do a business podcast where I actually interview entrepreneurs. So John's like, I'll make mine an interview show. Carve a sub niche. And then John realized, oh shucks, there's seven people already doing that. I don't wanna be the eighth version of that. I don't wanna be a me too. Oh, me too. I also have an interview-based podcast, me too. Me and these other seven people all have this. John was smart enough to know even 9 years ago that that wasn't the best choice to make. So John carved a micro niche. And this was the best, he says, was the best decision of his business career. And people violently, passionately tried to talk him out of it. And they were all, he's what he said. John created the first ever daily business podcast interviewing entrepreneurs. The only one. So John went from a competing with 300 other podcasts to then 700 podcasts to then he became the only daily business podcast interviewing entrepreneurs when daily. So he was the best daily show. He was also the worst daily show because he was the only daily show. Guys, let me just ask you this question. What are you willing to be the only thing for? I say this all the time. Carve a niche so tight. Carve a micro niche so tight that only you fit inside of this. You want to eliminate imposter syndrome? You want to get over this all this comparison? Here's how you do it. Stop competing. Stop comparing. And carve a micro niche so that you are the only one. Guys, this was absolutely pivotal for John's success. Now, I got a few case studies. Guys, this was our first movement-based business. Okay, and some of you guys, if you're a brick and mortar, if you're a service provider, okay, if you're a service provider, financial, professional, insurance agent, real estate agent, mortgage broker, if you are a traditional service provider, just drop a comment. Just say that's me. Guys, this was for my brick and mortar financial planning business. And let me show you how I applied movement-based marketing even back then. Okay, I took a stand. I took a stand for retirement-aged residents in a very small part of Northern California. It's called Solano County. Not the biggest county at all. I took a stand for people 60 and up, retirement-aged people in my county that had about 4 or 5 main cities. The stand I took was I took a stand to help them become what we called becoming retired and free. Because I saw that a lot of people were retiring, but retired and afraid, retired and worried, retired and very nervous. You guys know the number one fear of people in approaching retirement or in retirement is the fear of running out of money. So imagine you work your whole life to now retire and you can't even enjoy it because there's this constant nagging fear that you're gonna go broke before you die. And so we wrote this book called Retire and Free, The Unconventional Path to Financial Certainty and Fulfillment. I took a stand for my customers against the typical Wall Street-based investment industry. I took a stand. I found out that many of those firms, many of those people were not explaining things to their customers. They were keeping them confused. They had no idea what was really going on. It was kind of boring and very intimidating. So I was like, well, what if we just did, instead of doing boring and intimidating events or communication, what if we actually did fun retirement, educational, and social events? What if we actually made this fun? And what if we actually spoke in plain English so people could understand? What if we actually gave people the dignity of understanding what their options were so they can make their own decision? Which, by the way, is not how the industry operates. So that's the stand that we took, guys. We did these really cool events. We would do client appreciation parties. My wife would, hey, babe. I'm trying to get my wife to come on camera here. She'd make these amazing baskets. We had these amazing dinners. Guys, people would talk about these. This was the highlight of the year, okay? Now, here's an example. I was in the financial services industry. Guys, that's a $1 trillion industry. So here's how I niched it down. I picked a core product. Okay, that's a clue for some of you. I picked a core product. I wasn't trying to represent every single financial company on the planet. I wasn't like, oh, I'm a one-stop shop. I can do everything. I picked one core product to be an expert in. And that core product happened to have no fees. And it offered principal protection. It guaranteed people's savings can never go down. And so for the audience, I wanted to serve people that were looking to be a little bit more conservative with some of their money. Now that they're retirement, this was a great product to show them. Most of them had never seen it before because their Wall Street-based investment advisors don't like these products. And most of them can't even sell them. So I picked a product, a niched product. And I built my practice around that one product initially. And then I picked a micro niche audience. I began to discover, so one, of course, retirement age people, 55 and up. Two, it was a local business, so I was able to just work people around my office. More on that later. And I just began thinking, I was talking to my wife, and I'm like, hey, and I was talking to our team. I was like, hey, who are our favorite customers? Like, who are our favorite clients? People that we really like to work with, who seem to really enjoy working with us. And we quickly realized that for this business, they were females, they were nurses, they were single, divorced, most of them. And we ended up realizing most of them were Christians. And we didn't really know that was happening at this time. We were sending out mailers. We were sending out mailers, inviting the entire community. But as we began to look at our best clients, we saw this pattern. So for some of you, I'm going to bring up some guests here pretty soon. Your micro niche is right under your nose. It's right under your nose. You just haven't noticed it because you haven't maybe looked close enough. But who are your favorite clients? Who are the people you have gotten the best results for? Who actually appreciates you the most? You don't have to work with everybody. So once we knew this, guess what happened, guys? We went all in on this niche. Let me go backwards here for a second. Did you guys happen to catch this book cover? Guys, let me give you guys some new ones here. Did you guys happen to catch the color scheme of this book cover? Is this a very manly book cover? Just put in the comments right now. Is this book cover more masculine or more feminine? Just put that in the comment. Put that in the comment. This is more of a masculine or feminine book cover. Guys, the luggage is pink and yellow. And that's clearly a lady, a woman in the car by herself. This book cover was completely picked for my micro niche audience. Guys, that's the strategic stuff that you can do when you actually pick a micro niche. But you can never brand and market this way when you're trying to reach. But Pedro, wait a minute, Pedro. I see men in this picture. Yeah. You know what? You know where these men came from? These men came because some of these women that we market to were married and they brought their husbands. Or they would refer us their friends. That's why there's men here. So guys, are you catching this? Let me know. Okay, here's our second movement-based business. Our 100X Academy. Global movement, serving faith-based entrepreneurs. Built this from scratch. This is pre-corona, obviously. This was, I think, I don't know, September, October of 2019. Over 700 people from all over the world. South Africa, Singapore, Australia, all across America. 700 people flying into Vacaville, California on a company that was barely a year old. Guys, how do you do that? You do what I'm showing you here. You carve a micro niche, you create movement-based messages, and we built all this on the back of challenges. So this was the entrepreneurship space. But then we niched it down, and it was faith-based entrepreneurship and online marketing. But then we also micro-niched it, where this was primarily not even just all faith-based. It was got even niched tighter to start out with charismatic Christians. And if you don't know what that is, don't worry about it. It's a micro, teeny, tiny niche of this. There's obviously billions of Christians. This was me serving a very teeny, tiny micro niche of the Christian faith, who also and wanted to learn entrepreneurship and online marketing. And then lastly, guys, and we did this all in the back of challenges. This is my free Facebook group where I run my free challenges in. Over 66,000 people are in that Facebook group. This 414 challenge was done a year ago. It was our biggest challenge at that time. And then just most recently in January, we did a wisdom challenge. John Maxwell was part of that. Jennifer Allwood was part of that. Pete Vargas was part of that. Onyx Singhal got some of the biggest influencers in both spirituality and entrepreneurship. Join me in that. Okay? So are you guys seeing how we've done this once, not twice, but now three times? So guys, and then here's the third one. And then we were so successful building 100X movement on the back of challenges. A year ago, we launched Crush It with Challenges. I got launched to the market as the challenge guy. And here's how this one works. Now I'm in the online marketing space. Guys, can we all agree the online marketing space is very big? So what did I do? I have a niche offer. I'm the challenge guy. I just teach challenges. And when I say just, I mean, you know what I mean? Like challenges is everything right now, but I'm the challenge guy. I'm not trying to be the membership site guy. I'm not trying to be the funnel guy. I'm not trying to be the survey guy. I'm not trying to be the stage guy. I'm very clear. I'm the challenge guy. I'm okay with that. Like I'm good with that. And guess what? Before I became the challenge guy, guess who was the challenge guy? Put it in the chat. Before I became the challenge guy, who was the challenge guy before me? Oh, there wasn't one. There wasn't one. I am the only challenge guy. Just like JLD 9 years ago was the only daily live business interviewing podcast. Well, Pedro, I think there's hundreds, maybe thousands of daily live interview podcasts now. Yeah, there are. But you know what? None of them as big as John, because John was first. John was first. There is something about being first. You don't have to always be first, but if you can help it, I'd rather be first. Okay? And then guys, you've seen what we've done. Movement Maker Challenge, Category King Challenge, did the Power Shift Challenge with Damon John, Grant Cardone made an appearance in that challenge, Ryan Dice, Barbara Corcoran. Guys, becoming the challenge guy has allowed me to connect with people I would never have connected with if I was just another marketing guy trying to do all the things. Are you getting the point? And now, I want to show you guys that how regular people just like you are applying these concepts. So, I want to tell you guys about Stephen and Chelsea. And I actually, hold on a second, wait a minute, hold on. Hold on a second, I hear a knock at the door. Who could this be knocking at my door? Is there a knock right here on the door? Is there a knock? There's a knock, wait, what? Hold on a second, what? Oh my, wait a minute, how can they be on the slide and here in person? So making a live appearance here at the Crush It headquarters, Stephen, Chelsea, and Kai in the flesh. What's up, guys? They just happened to be vacationing in Newport Beach and at the perfect time, the week of our challenge. And I was like, instead of just us throwing up a slide, I was like, well, guys, come on in. And this is Kai.
Yep.
Kai is the cutest baby on the internet, if you didn't know. If you have a baby, your baby's cute too. We just really like this one. And so, guys, this is Stephen and Chelsea. Literally, they are a great example of micro-niching. Guys, so you guys teach people. You guys, the core thing you teach is how to make money on Amazon, right?
Yep.
How to make money on Amazon. How many people do you think, guys, teach how to make money on Amazon today?
It's too many to count. I mean, not since we're in the niche, we get all the ads. Yeah. You know? I mean, so many. I see a new person every day.
It's at least hundreds.
Yeah.
Okay. At least hundreds and hundreds of people. You guys definitely were not first to market with this. Okay. But you guys built the program, you were in the space. So tell folks a little bit just a quick story about that you guys had the product, how you launched it with the webinar, and then kind of what happened when you guys felt like you were stuck a little bit. And I really want to talk about this, the micro niche that I think was the beginning. Come here.
Yeah.
All right. So Stephen, so what happened, man? Tell us people kind of where things were at and this power of micro niching, because there are people who are going to doubt this, who are going to fight, and you know, because Stephen's an awesome coach in our program, and you've seen people wrestle with us.
Talk
about kind of where you guys were and that life-altering conversation that we had together where you decided.
Uh-huh.
You guys both decided to actually go in on a micro niche. Just talk about that while I play with Kai for a second.
Yeah. Oh man, you guys, this conversation is so important, and I just want you to pay attention, because like Peter said, like we help out coaching in some of these high level masterminds, and this is the number one thing that people like. It's probably the number one mistake that you can avoid starting today. You know, I think the camera's up here, right? So So I just want to look you guys in the eyes and say, like, pay attention, because it was on a call just like this where we were with Pedro and we were kind of wrestling. I mean, like we had done, we figured out this thing, right? That we felt like we could build a movement on, because it was something that affected our lives. We're like, families everywhere need to know this thing, because it gave us a ton of freedom, financial freedom. And so we started teaching this thing, but we started doing kind of the webinars and the eBooks and the VSLs and all the things that you might hear people people say to do online. But we hadn't done this one thing, right? Which was niching down, was carving this niche so tight that we are the only one who fit in it. Because when we thought about our product, we're like, passive income, right? Everyone wants passive income. But I think I've heard Pedro say this before, if your product is for everyone, it's for no one. And when you do this, like we had a little bit of success with the webinar, a little bit of success with like all these other things. But we brought in all these people into our group that just weren't aligned. They weren't resonating with each other. There wasn't this like movement type of growth because people just weren't similar. Like it was just like all over the place, the type of people that that we brought in. And so I was on a call with Pedro that he actually kind of said something he said on this call. So I want you to pay attention to this. He said, look at your results, right? Look at who's had success with what you've done. So we took a look at like all of our case studies, all the people we had worked with, and the thing that kind of emerged was stay-at-home moms. And I remember the conversation because we were like, this is kind of like around the time we were going to this conference too, and we were wrestling with this. We're like, will this work? Like stay-at-home moms, like,
and we weren't parents yet either. Yeah. We were looking to the future, but not even parents at all. I wasn't pregnant or anything. And Stephen does a lot of the main training, so it's like, how's this gonna resonate? Like Stephen talking to like young moms and families, like, is that it? Just it felt like almost like the wrong thing to do, but we knew that we had to step into that and really niche it down and even go further than that. And we had seen that not only was it stay-at-home moms that were huge success stories, but homeschool stay-at-home moms, and being able to carve that down like that was just so important.
Yeah. So this photo you guys are seeing was us after our first time. So when we niched this down, it was May 2019. We weren't parents. Like
I think that's huge. So I mean, so first of all, a couple things.
Yeah.
Stay-home moms right now, that's a niche, not a macro niche. When you guys went from stay-home mom to stay-home homeschooling moms, that's when we applied the micro. And then we have a lot of those stay-home moms in our community. So I remember you guys were like, hey, stay-home homeschool moms, like tell me. And they did some research and we found out, oh, there's this really popular stay-home homeschool curriculum.
Right.
And that curriculum was, you use that in some of your ads
on. Yeah.
And so guys, that's what got, now, of course, as our business has grown, you know, they're serving more people, but they got the fire. They caught the momentum in that micro niche. And I love what Chelsea said. Like, I mean, now you see Kai and it's like, yeah, now they're a family and she's a stay-home mom. But when they agreed to just trust this process, and trust me as a coach and mentor and micro niche, they weren't even parents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I talk a lot about having authority and it's like, well, how did they have authority to teach, you know, stay home moms? They don't even have any kids. Well, they weren't teaching parenting. They're not teaching a breastfeeding class. They're not teaching that. They were teaching how to make money on Amazon. And so, guys, sometimes again, aren't you guys glad you didn't disqualify yourself from this niche?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, and you guys, like, this is the one thing that you can avoid because, like, there's this poverty kind of mindset about, oh, if I narrow it down too far, I'm excluding all the people that it should be for, right? And this program that it gives us, like, not just stay-at-home homeschool moms, it's stay-at-home homeschool moms in a very specific program. You know, it's like 50,000 people, I think, on a Facebook interest, you know?
Yeah.
And you have this mental game of, like, oh, it's too narrow, right? But when you do this, it makes actually everything easier.
Yeah.
It makes everything easier because now the language can be hyper-focused for that person.
So
we started listening to our people, and one of our students was like, I built this business during nap time. And we're like, oh, that's it, that's the language, you know? And so that's like part of our thing now. Hey, build a business during nap time. We frame everything through that. And when you guys narrow down, it makes it so much easier to talk to these people and use words and resonate with them and serve them at the highest level. Like when you're like this product for everyone, you don't really know how to serve them.
Yeah.
But when you narrow it down, you know how to like create bonuses and products and services to serve that specific person at a way higher level. Yeah. And that's what makes you stand out.
And this is, and guys, because they were serving a tighter community, they were able to see trends faster, pick up on the language. You talked about nap time. I think their best hook that I've ever heard is, we help stay home moms create six-figure side hustles during nap time. I'm like, that's never going to not work. That's cool. So, guys, you guys can hang out for a bit backstage.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right. So in the VIP bags, I didn't tell people, you've done a couple of really good challenges lately, right?
Yeah. So share some of the results.
It's a little bit before. I mean, we probably should let them know.
It's okay if we share that with you guys, just a little bit of like the power of this, what you guys are running.
Is it okay if they share their success I don't want anybody to be, we don't want any jealousy. We don't want any haters to be like, you know, like, no, share away. This is, everyone here wants to win and they want to celebrate your success. So what's happened for you guys since you began these challenges to the micro niche?
Yeah. So
the first one was how much?
First one, you know, everything, it's like, it was a step of faith, right? We spent, I think, $2,000 on Facebook ads, maybe $2,000 or $3,000, which for us at the time, you know, we were in this completely different industry. That was a stretch. I was like, wow, this is intense, right? And but that first challenge is $60,000.
$2,000 in ads, first challenge, the micro niche, did $60,000.
We were able to work with 30 families who are now launching businesses and are actually some of our coaches, which is super cool.
First 30 customers.
Okay. So, another challenge.
How many guys would be okay? How many guys think that'd be a pretty cool story if, and right there? If you can invest $2,000 to make $60,000, that's a 30x, 30 times return on your investment, which is, guys, nobody does that. None of the gurus do that. Okay, so that was the first challenge. And yet, they're like, oh my God, what happened? And right now, I'm like, you do it again. You guys, the second challenge, what happened?
Yeah, stretch a little further.
Yeah, so it was in October 2019. And I think we spent around, was it $10,000? Yeah, about $10,000 in ads, which again, felt like such a huge investment. Like,
which, oh my gosh,
yeah, it was, yeah, totally. And it was like, are we going to get that back? What's going to happen?
It was like gambling a little bit.
The Facebook casino.
Yeah.
Well, again, this is the whole thing. With micro niching, movement messaging, and challenges, you take the Facebook casino and you make it a Facebook ATM machine.
No.
See, that's what we do. That's like so it felt like gambling, but you spent $10,000. What did you guys do on that second challenge?
That second challenge is $100,000. So that was the first
six figure month ever.
Crazy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Crazy.
And then they're like, what do we do now? And I was like, what?
Do it again.
So then what happened?
We're like inching our way up.
Yeah.
You know? So this
little by little.
Right around that time you saw that photo, we were like, okay, let's spend 20, right? We went 2010, let's go 20,000 on ads. And it sounded crazy. It was like spending a car on Facebook ads. You know?
A decent car.
Yeah.
20,000 still buys you a decent car.
Yeah. And so we spent, and I remember we were in Nashville because we were recording some of the Crush It like trainings and things.
And at that time we had a newborn. He was like a month old. Steven's in Nashville. And I get this call and he's just like, oh my gosh, like the Facebook ads are really working. Can I pour my money in? So we just let him go.
I was like, how much money can I
pay?
How much are you letting me spend?
The system that Pedro teaches, like, it was self-liquidating. So
which means
every dollar we were putting in was actually producing $2 back on the front.
So every dollar they're putting in ads, because of how we help them design their challenge, they actually had an offer they were making before the challenge even started. So every dollar they're putting in ads, they're making $2 back immediately before the challenge even began. So wisely, he goes back to, you know, Chelsea's like, hey, this is kind of working. I put a little bit of gas on this fire.
Yeah.
So
every dollar put in, thing too. How many can I put in? Yeah. She's like, as many as we can.
See, that's the right answer. And sometimes we're a little slow on that one, but not Chelsea. Chelsea figured that one out pretty good.
So we figured out the credit card situations and everything, but we ended up spending $60,000 on Facebook ads, like in a 2-week period.
But again, so some guys, oh, I don't have $60,000 to spend. They didn't spend their $60,000. They were just recycling money through the Facebook ATM machine. So we'll talk more about that later on. Yeah, so we'll cover that more on Thursday.
Probably $120,000 on just like, you know. So it was doubling the money on the front end. And then that challenge, you guys, was our first seven-figure challenge. So we did over, it was like $1.1 million.
$1 million challenge. Okay. Not $1 million a year, $1 million challenge. Mm-hmm. Steven and Chelsea are still not famous. They're still not mega influencers. They're still very much, you know, just getting started in this monster industry of Amazon. Mm-hmm. And they're crushing it, guys. Crushing it in a teeny tiny micro niche.
Crazy.
And they did their, and here's the coolest part of the story. They did $1 million challenge before I ever did one. Up until this time, the biggest challenge I ever did was $500,000. And it was the right month prior. So students, people I've been able to support into and teach and train, broke that glass ceiling, broke the 4-minute mile for the rest of us. Guys, honest, just straight up honest truth. I didn't even think you could make $1 million on a challenge. I was like, wait a minute, you can make $1 million doing this? I was like, I just didn't even have vision for that. So when they did it, I was like, oh my word. So you guys have now gone on to do not one, not two seven-figure challenges, not even three, but you guys just completed your fourth seven-figure challenge, guys. And this is on a product that at one point was dead. You guys, I remember you guys were contemplating just going doing something else totally different.
Yeah, we kind of had a lot of balls in the air, so to say, just trying different things. And but we knew this one had something on it. It was like, this is it's a movement. Yeah. Like, because it affected our family in such a way that we're like, this is worth leaning into. Yeah. But hitting a wall for you, I mean, you guys know if you're entrepreneurs, it's like you hit walls, you know? Yep. Yep. And that's why getting around Pedro, getting around some of his challenges, like, you guys are feeling fired up right now, is because, like, it's gonna get you through these walls, you know, get you over the walls. And there's so many times that we wanted to quit. Even this last challenge was like, you know, there's some pushback as far as like technical things and Facebook being weird. But you guys, this is worth it. This is so worth it. So awesome. We just started to like encourage you can do this absolutely. Too.
Yeah. And you guys are gonna hang backstage. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so I get kind of that. So that's great. Anyway. All right, guys. Are you listening to this story? Now, I'm gonna bring up someone real quick because I know he has a time crunch. How many guys enjoyed hearing that testimony? Micro niche for the win. Micro niche movement based messaging challenge for the win. Micro niche movement based messaging plus challenges equals everything you want in your life. Hello. Okay. Now, we're gonna go for another 10 minutes, guys. So for VIPers, don't worry, you're not missing anything, because I'm right here. Okay. But I want you guys to meet a guy who is probably my newest addition to the Crush It With Challenge crew. Someone who just crushed his very first challenge. You may know this. A lot of you know this guy because he's been emailing you about this challenge. And this is none other than two-time New York Times bestselling author, my man, John Acuff.
Hey, what's going on, Pedro?
Boom. All right, buddy. I know we got limited time here.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, I want to come on again. Like, we need to do this multiple times because I will be your best spokesperson.
You will come on again, guys. John Acuff, John, am I lying? Aren't you really a two-time New York?
It's true. I've got a new one coming out in a couple weeks, so hopefully three times.
We'll talk about that in a second. So, guys, this is like a real, you know, I'm not talking about like Amazon stuff. New York Times bestselling author two times, just ran your first ever challenge. You crushed it.
It was insane. I'll never launch a book in a different way. You told me at the beginning the hardest thing for you is going to be you'll never want to stop doing these. You were 100% right. I saw a massive life change, massive engagement. Like, yeah, I feel like you're Ponce de Leon and just showed me the fountain of youth. And I was like, what?
Bro, take me back to my Portuguese roots. So listen, the reason why John is here, aside from his stunning good looks, is John, so VIP, guys, let me talk about VIP real quick. I told you guys that VIP, the first 1,000 would sell out very quickly. That happened. We had over 1,000 people in VIP before the challenge even started. There's already over 1,500 people in VIP. And so I started to feel bad because I had only purchased 1,000 copies of John Lee Dumas' book, The Common Path, Uncommon Success. So the first 1,000 of you who bought VIP, some of you already got it. You got the swag bag on the way with that brand new release book, which doesn't even ship till today. But I started to feel bad for the other people. And I'm like, because I was wanting to just go above and beyond. And then I remember that my man right here, John Acuff, who I just helped him do a challenge to launch his book. I was like, John, is there any way?
What?
Like,
Is look at it. Dude, and then we printed the interior cover too? Come on.
Guys.
Who does that?
I didn't want anybody to have FOMO. So anybody who wants to still come into the VIP backstage pass, this goes away today, by the way. You cannot join backstage after today. I have ordered another 1,000 copies of John's newest book. It's called Soundtracks. It's a cool book title, but the tagline, John, is what I love the most. What's the tagline of your book?
The Surprising Solution to Overthinking.
Okay, this is it right here. Helping you guys overcome overthinking. The number one reason, and tell me if you agree, Steven's off camera, but still in the room. The number one reason why people do not commit to a micro niche, in my humble opinion, after doing this for 3 years, after helping thousands and thousands and tens of thousands of people, they overthink what micro niche to pick. So my man John has a book on how to overcome overthinking. I was like, bro, it's perfect. Give me 1,000 of them. So when you join VIP today, and by the way, guys, like, this is the last day at movementmaker.com/VIP. The first 1,000 of you already got JLD's book. The second 1,000 of you is going to get John's newest book. John, I know you got to go just a minute or so about how awesome is this book and what can people expect to benefit and receive once they get
sure.
it.
Sure. Well, we asked 10,000 people. The researcher I work with, Mike Beasley, PhD, we asked 10,000 people if they struggle with overthinking. 99.5% of people said yes. Overthinking steals time, creativity, and productivity. And here's my thing. If you can worry, you can wonder. If you can spin, you can soar. If you can doubt, you can dominate. So what if you can have all your thoughts work for you, not against you? What if they can push you forward, not hold you back? And so whatever goal you're working on, what's getting in the way is overthinking. 81% of Americans, according to New York Times, want to write a book. Less than 1% do every year. 81% want to, 1% do. What happens? They overthink. So whether you're a stay-at-home mom that's thinking about a side hustle, whether you're a dad, a CEO, we all struggle with overthinking. And 2020 was catnip for overthinking. I mean, you think about all the things that happened. So here's my promise. If you want a new anthem for your life, if you want to build some new soundtracks that help you launch into whatever goal you want, if you want a slingshot that's bright and blue and helpful, check out the VIP. It's the best way to get 1,000 copies right away.
John, this book don't even ship for a few more weeks, right?
Exactly. It's not even available yet.
Not even available yet. You're like, Pedro, how are you getting people's books before they're available? Well,
Challenges work. That's the reason. Like when Pedro said, John, you're going to have to try this, I was like, oh, I don't know, Pedro, I don't know. And then I tried it. And every day during the challenge, I would text the results and be like, are you kidding me right now? Like, I wish I had an hour to talk to you guys because I would share story after story after story. So right now, if you're on the edge of this, like I've never done one before. I did one like 3 weeks ago. So the paint is still wet. And like, this is a fresh story. This isn't 2 years ago. So hear me now. Like, it was amazing. I've bothered every friend of mine with the Pedro story. My wife is so tired of hearing me talk about Pedro. So yeah, I hope that this is coming through. Like a virtual environment sometimes challenging, but please, no, this. The challenges work. Like I just did one and it was dope and I loved it. And expect some more from me in the future. Like I want to see you in my challenge. Don't doubt. Like Pedro's going to jump on mine next because it's too fun.
Oh my God. So good. Guys, and listen, John had to move out of his comfort zone to do this. Because when you become a two-time New York Times bestselling author and you're used to doing a lot of big keynotes and a lot of pre-recorded training, I'm like, John, you gotta go live. He's like, I don't do live. I'm like, John, you're gonna do live. He's like, bro, I don't wanna do that. I'm like, John, you're doing this. He's like,
well, and you said, and it's home run content. Like, you're going, we're gonna super serve people. It's home run. Like, John, I don't wanna see any thin idea. I don't wanna see any small ideas. You're gonna give people amazing content in the challenge. So, yeah, it stretched me. And it happened because I said, Pedro, how the heck do I launch a book when there aren't live events? Every live event is on pause right now. And he said, well, you don't need a live event. You got a challenge. And I was like, what's the challenge? And then just mind blowing. So, Pedro, I love what you're doing. I hope everyone watching this checks it out. It's so worth it. I'm a huge fan. I could talk about it for hours, man. Thanks for having me on. And I'll get these books to you.
Let's go, man. We need them quick because I gotta ship out these VIPs. And we'll have you back to tell your challenge story for sure between now. All right, buddy. Love you so much, man. I'm seeing some comments. Oh, Pedro, do I get both books? No, because if you were in the first 1,000, I already sent you a book. And that book has already been shipped to you, right? So if you're in the first 1,000, you got John Lee Dumas' book, okay? Before you can buy it. And now if you're in the second 1,000, you're going to get my man John Acuff's book, Overthinking. All right, guys, I got to land the plane. Permission for 10 more minutes. Can I go 10 more minutes today? Permission to go 10 more minutes, and I'm just going to power through and have us out of here in 10 minutes. But I want to just wrap this up and ask and get you guys off to your assignment. Okay. This has worked for hundreds and hundreds of our students. Gina Lester has the 5-day Crush College Admissions Challenge. She's helping parents get their seniors into college by helping them master the admission process. Gina's done multiple challenges now, 3. She's made about 14 grand from each. An idea I have for Gina is Gina can even further micro niche this down and focus on college admissions. Like I'm in California. There's a lot of California parents who are having a hard time getting their kids into the UC system. So you could do a micro niche of the 5-day Crush Your UC, University of California College Admission Challenge. Do you think a parent of a senior or junior in California who wants their kids to go to a UC school is not going to want to be in that challenge? Of course it will. I think when Gina niches down one more time, she'll blow it up. Guys, there are many, many write book challenges. But guess what? My man Andrew is the only guy I've ever seen. It's not write a book challenge. It's the 5-day write a children's book challenge. And here's another niche. Write your first children's book in 5 days or less. Guys, that's micro niching. And Andrew is killing it. He's doing five figures on his challenges now. You know, $9,500 on the third challenge. He's launched his coaching program, his business. He's off the races. He's going to become the guy. If he keeps this up, he will become the guy, the number one go-to guy to help first-time children's book authors. And like, Pedro, how can that be a business? It is. Multiple six figures. If he keeps at it, it'll be a seven-figure business. Tamara Engwall has a launch your nonprofit 5-day challenge focusing on helping brand new people launch their very first faith-based nonprofit as a 508, not a 501. So you have a deep niche here. They don't even do the work. They actually are an affiliate for a company that actually does the work. So this was an affiliate offer, which means they ran the challenge, they sold it, they make a bunch of money, and they don't even have to do the work, guys. That's super smart. Rachel Kachadorian, her 7-day crafts to cash challenge, helping crafters actually sell their crafts on Etsy. Hey guys, that's a niche. Brand new people to Etsy, crafters who want to turn their crafts into cash. First challenge, 100 grand. Guys, Ivan and Marina, they're in the systemic work niche. I'm like, what is systemic work? I don't even know what this is. Guys, it's a real thing. And the only people who know about this are the people who are in this niche. And guys, they launched their business, 130 people in the first challenge, 10% conversion, 14K, very first time. Guys, Julia Winston. I mean, some of you guys are into the real spiritual stuff, transformational. I call it the woo-woo business, and I love the woo-woo business. Guys, Julia Winston has a prayer challenge teaching business owners how to pray profits into your business unapologetically. You're like, Pedro, no way someone could carve a niche teaching people how to pray for their business and make money. Oh, yes, you can. She can, because she carved a micro niche. First challenge made $21,000. 2020 made her first six figures in the year, and just last month, she sends me a text. First six-figure month in her entire life. Guys, what are you seeing here? Micro niche, movement messaging, and challenges. So here's your Movement Maker Day 2 questions. Are you committed to picking one micro niche? Will you actually make the choice to pick one? Okay. And here's how I'm going to help you start to hone this in. What problem or problems are you uniquely, currently gifted and skilled at solving? Guys, I can tell you this right now. If you look, I'm telling you this, guys. This is part of this formula. This is part of the formula. It's you tapping into unique giftings, unique skill sets, things that set you apart, things that make you different than everybody else. Most of us are trying so hard to fit in, and yet all of the success is by not fitting in. So, do you have any unique skills, passions? What's easy for you that's hard for other people? What do you often get complimented on? Okay, there's some clues. There's some clues here, okay? And then the last question. These questions are going to help you start to hone in on your micro niche, plus the homework that's in the Crush It Lab. Here's a big question that changed the game for me. I believe this. Talk about woo-woo. This might be the most woo-woo thing I ever say, and I believe this to my core. Whoever loves the most will win. Love is the most potent and powerful business strategy on the planet today. Because whoever loves the most will do the most, will give the most, will serve the most. When you serve your micro niche out of a place of love, compassion, empathy, you will go so much further beyond what any other service provider, vendor, business, or brand has ever done. I call it ruining people. Write that down. Here's another bonus question. Who can I ruin? R-U-I-N. Who can I ruin with my love for them, with my service to them? Because if you're willing to outlove other people in your industry, in your niche, by serving the most, you can win. But here's the challenge. Here's the challenge. We all love different things, which is the beauty of this. You don't love everyone the same. You can't possibly love everyone the same because there's too many things to love and people love. So this is about you getting a little bit more honest about thinking about who are the people who, for Stephen and Chelsea, it was homeschool moms. They were able, even though they weren't homeschool moms, they just were able to connect their hearts in a way to have compassion and empathy to serve these homeschool moms who want to help stay home, homeschool moms who want to help their husbands, who want to take the pressure off their spouse, who want to have a little something going on while they're raising their kids. And they created an environment where they were able to love and serve that micro niche far beyond what any other Amazon influencer, Amazon trainer could ever possibly do. So they won, and they're still going to keep winning in that micro niche. So who can you love more than anyone else in your industry? Guys, I'm telling you right now, don't overthink this. Don't overanalyze this. This is the secret to helping you find your micro niche. Well, Pedro, what if I pick the wrong micro niche at first? It doesn't matter. You're going to learn. But your best shot at picking a winning micro niche, one, commit to picking one. And then two, let's find that intersection between your gifts, your skills, your past experiences, your key relationships, and where can we overlap those gifts and skills and talents and relationships, and where can we overlap that and intersect that with a group of people that you have massive compassion and caring for? Because guys, this is going to cost. All of us on stage, everyone you're going to meet in this challenge, we work hard. And I'm telling you right now, if you don't love the people that you're serving enough, it's going to be tough to take this all the way through, okay? So guys, I'm going to wrap up here. Thank you guys for giving me the grace to go a little bit longer today, but we have some surprise guests. This is your last day at joining the Backstage VIP. MovementMaker.com/VIP2021 is where you go and do that. And I got an extra 1,000 books, so everyone's going to get a copy. Any of you who are joining now are going to get an amazing swag bag from us with some Crush It gear, some Crush It stuff, and John Acuff's newest book, Soundtracks, How to Overcome Overthinking. They interview 10,000 people. And we say 98% of people said they struggle with overthinking. My word. So you guys, your assignment, make sure you're at MovementMaker.com. Text me the number. Text me Movement that number. Make sure you're VIP. Make sure you got your challenge buddy locked in. We'd love to see you report your findings from today. What was your big takeaways from today? Drop those in the Facebook group. Tag me. I want to see your stuff. I want to see your feedback. And then Gangster P is waiting for you at crushitlab.com to help you with today's homework. Guys, this concludes day 2 of the Movement Maker Challenge. Hope you had an amazing time with us today. Hope you enjoyed this as much as I enjoyed doing it for you. We are back here live today, tomorrow with day 3 as we get to go into movement-based messaging. And then day 4. It's all day 4. How to crush it with challenges is coming up on day 4. So guys, that's what we have to look forward to this week. And then Friday, it's going to be Party Friday with some cool stuff. So guys, love you so much. Please knock out the assignments. Please go live, engage with this content, engage with Gangster P at crushitlab.com. And if you haven't yet, join us in VIP. We're going there now with more Stephen and Chelsea. And my special guest here today is Selena Su, a publicity expert who's an expert at getting people featured on mega major press releases and press. And she also has a lot of experience in helping people with their niching. So guys, we're off to VIP right now. We love you so much. That's at movementmaker.com/VIP2021. We'll see you back here live tomorrow for how to create movement-based messaging. Love you guys so much. See you tomorrow. Peace.